The country we know today as East Africa has been forged in some of the most violent activity this planet has ever seen. Of the thousands of volcanoes that attended its birth, only one is still active, and it is called Lengai. But today, a new Lengai looks out over the East African scene, as fiery and spectacular as any volcano. This Lengai is something else again. The hot air balloon called Lengai has made more than 100 flights over East Africa, over its great herds of game, its forests, lakes, and mountains. So come with us for a wild and wonderful ride on our safari by balloon. One of the most beautiful places in East Africa is Lake Naivasha. And it's here that the story of the new Lengai begins. Among the many creatures that live along the lakeshore are two rather extraordinary people, Joan and Alan Root. They are wildlife filmmakers, and when not on safari, they live here in their own private little paradise. Some of their animal friends, like Sally the hippo and this otter, are orphans that have ended up in Joan's care. Others are wild creatures that have given the Roots their trust. Most of their pets are unusual, striped hyenas or porcupines. One is so unusual that it's almost unbelievable. This crazy mixed-up beast is an aardvark. Her name is Million, which is short for Aardvark a Million Miles for One of Your Smiles. But the Roots are filmmakers, and for much of the year, they must leave this family behind and camp out in the bush. In contrast to his gentleness with animals, Alan Root is a demon about life and lives it to the hilt. Despite his high living and low flying, he is intensely serious about his work and has produced some of the finest and most sensitive wildlife films ever made. He is always looking for a new way of seeing things, and in particular from the air, the element he loves. In general, aeroplanes are too fast and helicopters too noisy for filming animals. Here he has been testing out a camera clamped onto the strut, but it's only useful for general aerial views. 12 years earlier, Alan had flown in the hydrogen balloon Jambo on her pioneering flights in Africa and been impressed by her smooth, quiet, but very expensive flight. The new breed of hot air balloons, however, were apparently easy to operate and cheap to run. On his next trip to England, Alan arranged for a demonstration flight, and before he was 6 feet off the ground, he had bought one. Next, he had to learn to fly it. So the English balloonist, Phil Dunnington, came to spend his leave at Naivasha to give Alan instruction. Phil had been to Africa before, but never to anything quite like this.
Yes, well, nobody's flown in these conditions before at this kind of altitude, and it does affect the performance of the balloon, but I think with one this size, we should be all right.
Over lunch, what was left of it, he explained how they would go about inflating and launching the balloon early next morning.
Well, once we've got the site, we can spread the balloon out.
Downwind in this direction.
So once we've got to the stage where we're using the burner to put hot air in and the balloon is beginning to be fully inflated, this is a tricky period, and when the crew on the crown rope need to be on the wall to let the top of the balloon up very slowly and gradually so that it rises fully inflated into the vertical position. And gradually we fill the balloon up with more hot air until it's what we call an equilibrium, where it's just ready to leave the ground, and all you need to do is put a few more squirts in and you're away.
That's when we open the champagne, right?
Fantastic. Here's the new balloon.
Yes, sir.
God, oh, this is unbelievably beautiful.
This is going to be fantastic. Look, you can see all the hippo trails where they've come in and out of the water.
Oh, yes.
And you can see the mud stirred up over there where there's obviously been one walking around this morning.
Yeah, well, the thing you've got to remember about a balloon is that it's got 4 tons of air inside it, 4 tons of inertia, so it takes some stopping, and you've got to anticipate its movements, particularly if you're going down.
Yeah.
Start rounding out well before you actually get to the point at which you want to round out. So you can't afford to talk and not watch.
It's going to take me quite a while, I think.
Do you want to have a try? And we'll go down and see if you can round out nicely just above these boats.
Okay.
Because there is no immediate response to the controls, flying a balloon takes a bit of getting used to. But Alan Root is one of those naturally well-coordinated people who get the hang of this sort of thing very quickly. Either got it or you haven't. a long time. He hadn't.
I think I've lifted a bit late, don't you?
I reckon you have.
What are we going to do? Are we getting waterlogged?
Yeah, we've got too much weight in to be able to lift out. I'm afraid the only option is for you to get out.
Rat leaving a sinking ship. Bring the boat!
Even with me out of the basket, it was still soggy and wouldn't lift off. But the big problem was the breeze, blowing the flame sideways so that we couldn't get any heat into the balloon. What we had to do was try and get the weight of the basket up onto the boat and then drive with the wind, allowing Phil to get the flame into the mouth of the balloon and heat it up that way. For me, that was a beautiful moment. It was the first time I'd seen my own balloon in the air. The next day, we tried ways of avoiding that sort of situation. If we ever made a long lake crossing, it would certainly be safer this way. It wasn't exactly elegant, but it did work, and I decided we'd always take the boat with us on any long safari, a decision that really paid off later in the year. With ballooning, you never have the faintest idea where or how your flight is going to end. We took off from exactly the same place each morning, but one day we'd land way out in the sticks and have to wait hours to be recovered. The next day we might land in the middle of an African village and have hundreds of willing but completely disorganized hands to help us pack up.
Well, I'll show you how it works. Just turn that tap on. Light that little flame there.
But it was the lake that attracted me most. I must have been doing about 15 miles an hour, I guess, when I hit, and the effect was rather like dipping a bucket over the side of a fast-moving boat. The basket scooped itself full of water, became a great sea anchor, and the wind blew the balloon over to such an angle that there was no way we were going to get it up again. At the speed we were dragging, there was a real danger of one of us getting caught up among the wires. The only thing to do was to open up the rip panel and let the balloon collapse. At least then it would stop dragging us along.
See if you can get off top of those bubbles of air in the pelvis.
I don't know about Phil as an instructor. For some reason, he'd never sunk a balloon before, and there was nothing about underwater ballooning in the book. So when help finally arrived, we had to work out our own salvage techniques. Except where it was held up by trapped air, the balloon sank very quickly, and only a half-empty gas cylinder kept the basket afloat. But just as trapped air was keeping part of the balloon up, trapped water was keeping most of it down.
We're never going to get it up like this.
We'd obviously enclosed tons of water down there. We could bail the boat all right, but there was only one way to let water out of the balloon.
Can you roll it so that we've got the least amount of water to come out?
Hold it, move up the front of it. Slide it up.
Mind the tune, huh?
But despite the occasional mishap, the lake was a perfect place for ballooning. As Alan became more proficient as a pilot, they were able to risk taking cameras up with them, and it was very encouraging to discover that birds, anyway, were not too disturbed by the balloon. Hopefully, it would be the same with larger animals. Lake Naivasha is not just beautiful, it is also bountiful. The underside of those lily pads are crawling with freshwater crayfish. The balloon proved to be an excellent means not only of catching them, but of cooking them too.
Come on, Phil, breakfast ready.
Great.
This is going to be hot. We've got to... Now watch your fingers.
Phil's leave was at an end now. Alan had passed his tests and got his balloon license. There were no more excuses for fun flying at Naivasha. The time had come to take Lengai on safari, to test it out over wild country and wild animals, and see if it really did work. Their first destination was the Mara Game Reserve, just 150 miles away. Alan's African assistants, Michael Enger and Jeffrey Kamau, carried enough gas for 20 flights, and Giles Camplin and Mike Price went along as recovery crew. The balloon can only be launched from a sheltered spot, so their camp had to be near some big trees. But shady spots are usually already occupied in Africa. The locals must be allowed to move on before visitors can move in and put their tents up.
The next morning, we still had company. I thought they'd take off as soon as I burned, but these old bull buffalo have lived for so long in this patch of forest that they weren't going to move out for anything. One of them became so blasé that we started calling him the airport manager. He watched every takeoff, and he was the first large animal that we photographed from the balloon. But it wasn't until we were actually flying over that beautiful Mara country that I found I'd made a very fundamental mistake. It wasn't me that needed a balloon license, it was Joan. I'm the photographer in the family, and whenever I wanted to film something, I had to hand over control to Joan. In other words, I ended up trying to give her flying lessons while looking through the viewfinder. And we'd often get situations where, because I was filming, I assumed Joan must be piloting. It'd go something like this. Oh, honey, I thought you were flying this thing.
Well, no, you didn't tell me to.
But can't you see I'm filming?
I'm sorry, I didn't notice. I was taking stills.
Okay, well, look, get down in the basket. These are thorny bushes. Hang on, here we go.
know I'm in charge if you don't tell me?
I don't know. I tell you what, if you hear the camera running, it means you're in command, okay?
Okay.
But Joan soon got the feel of it, and we started to get results. The big herds of buffalo were rather nervous, but then they usually are. A herd's always as shy as its most nervous member. This old bull was more relaxed. He could decide for himself when to run. Each animal had its own reaction to Lengai. Most weren't bothered by the balloon, but didn't like the sound of the burner. Others just didn't like the shadow.
Yeah.
While we were learning to handle things in the air, our recovery crew had a lot to learn on the ground. Mike and Giles have done this sort of thing for balloonists all over England and Europe. Over there, they try and figure which road will cross the balloon's path. In Africa, they could follow in a straight line and hope that not too much would get in their way.
Hello, Giles. I've crossed that small stream, the one with the swamp at the top end.
We're right there. Do you know how deep it is?
Well, no, but it can't be very deep. Why don't you get out and wade through it first?
I think we'll just go around the top end.
Then one day, I gave him a real problem. Just as we reached the edge of a large area of forest, I got carried away filming a herd of wildebeest. And that's literally carried away, because by the time I'd got my shot, the wind had carried us over the trees. We flew on for a while, but the forest was miles across, and we didn't have enough gas to reach open country. The people on the ground couldn't get to us if we landed in the forest, so there was only one thing we could do. Land among the trees, but as close as possible to the Mara River. Mike and Giles, with any luck, could then come downstream and collect us in the rubber boat.
The recovery crew picked up the boat from camp and got to the river as soon as they could. By this time, Joan and Alan had packed up the balloon and were laboriously bringing it to the river bank. The Mara River winds through some of the most exciting game country in Africa. For the most part, it is deep and slow moving, but in places it tumbles through rocky defiles and steep rapids. Among their many strange accomplishments, Giles and Mike are among the handful of people who have completely circumnavigated the British Isles. They were at home on water, and Michael and Ger would go with them to cope with any animals they met. But it was with some trepidation that they set out down the Mara. Africa lived up to their expectations, and after a couple of miles, these circumnavigators smashed their propeller in a rapid. It wasn't till late afternoon that they paddled their way to their rendezvous with the routes. The next morning, heavily laden, everybody set off downriver. In many ways, it was like ballooning, a slow, silent, barely controllable movement in a plump, inflated craft. And the reactions of the animals to it were as varied as they were to the balloon. As the balloon boatmen approached the next lot of rapids, they heard excited zebra calls, and ahead of them a large group was crossing. These animals were the forerunners of the herds of zebra and wildebeest that migrate into the Mara every year from the Serengeti. They had chosen a shallow place to cross, but the footing was treacherous and many were swept away. Though the rapids looked exciting, it was the slower stretches of river that, for Mike and Giles, made it quite different to anything they had seen around the British Isles.
That one's got a cough. Watch here. Don't go too close. Okay, pal. Round to the left a bit.
Holes. He's punctured one of the rear tubes as well.
That's okay. These are just holes in the floor, and we've lost one compartment, right?
We'll never get all this water out there. It's going to sink really deep in the water.
The rest of the trip down to the waiting vehicles was comparatively uneventful, just wet. But nothing had been lost or damaged. And as soon as Len Guy had been dried out, it could be flying again. The next few flights were made on behalf of the local game warden. He is a Maasai. He'd been very helpful to the Roots, and his brother was this area's candidate in Kenya's upcoming parliamentary elections. Alan offered to carry his campaign posters on the basket and make some flights outside the reserve over the Maasai villages. They probably lost a few votes when they stampeded these cattle, but on the whole, Len Guy was a great attraction in a land where conventional campaigning is difficult, to say the least. The lives of the Maasai are circumscribed by the needs of their cattle and the changing seasons. Apart from the occasional ceremony or cattle raid, there is very little to disturb the pastoral pace of life.
That was nice getting that guy there.
Yeah.
And he looked like him.
Small wonder, then, that they would desert their villages if the 120-foot-high balloon came in to land over their 5-foot-high houses. Strangely, although none of the Maasai knew about balloons, they'd all heard about parachutes. And Len Guy, they thought, must be one. When they saw that the Roots had actually survived the landing, they would rush up with their congratulations. Wherever the balloon landed, Maasai people would come from miles around. The warriors, suitably aloof, the women, excited by the fabric and the wicker basket, the kids, into everything. Len Guy was almost as exciting as a new cow. When people vote in Kenya, they put their mark next to a symbol. Our man's symbol was a lantern, and Len Guy just happened to be the biggest lantern in all Africa. Moonlight flight was a perfect finale for the campaign and a perfect opener for the flights over the game reserve that now followed.
Look at him underneath us, Joan.
Do you want the wide angle? Are you okay with it?
Yes, have you got the wide angle?
Come on.
Just give a boom. One little boom. Giles, I'm running very low on fuel. I think by far the best thing you can do...
Take over, Judge. Take over. Burn, honey, burn.
Long time since we burnt, and we're coming down.
Okay.
The balloon had been a success over the open Mara country. Alan wanted to try it over more rugged terrain. And as the warden's brother had just been elected with a big majority, it seemed a good time to move on. But then disaster struck the safari.
You guys notice any fabric back there?
The trailer tailboard had fallen open. The envelope had spilled out onto the track and been quickly torn to shreds. There was nothing worth salvaging and nothing else to do except pick up the pieces and send off for a new balloon. 6 weeks later it arrived, and the safari was on the road again. Their destination this time was Tsavo, a vast area noted for its dramatic scenery, a harsh mixture of granite hills and raw lava flows that look as though they've scarcely cooled. Tsavo is also noted for its big herds of elephants, and in particular, its great tuskers. It was elephants that drew the routes to what was otherwise a rather unsuitable piece of country, for in addition to the terrain, there were strong winds at times, and the whole place was clothed in some of Africa's most unfriendly vegetation. On their first morning, they tested the winds for strength and direction. The results were fairly conclusive. But only a superstitious fool would have seen any kind of omen in all those baby balloons bursting. Next day, the new Lengai took to the air.
On that first flight, we climbed to 5,000 feet to get a good look around. At times, we felt we were in a space capsule, tracking over the surface of the moon.
Yeah, I'll be going over that delicious lava.
We could clearly see where each lava flow had started, where it had gushed from the ground and crept across the country. And we could see all the trails that led up onto the lava flow from the surrounding bush. These trails are first made by elephant, whose weight crushes the lava, producing something like a coarse gravel path.
You can really see it so beautifully now. You can just see the dirt.
Strangely, there's a lot of vegetation up on the flows, and in the dry season, other animals follow the elephant paths to look for food.
I did it with a two-inch. Not too bad. But you can really see how, you know, it's nice to have that, because all the other animals we've got on the lava have been sort of stumbling a bit.
Yeah.
You only get them around the edge of these flows.
And there are even some species, like the clipspringer, that happily live full time among these rocks. At the base of one of the lava flows is a crystal clear spring called Mzima. Joan and I made a film there once, and we've spent many happy hours diving with the hippos, so this was an entirely new angle on them. There was even one of our old friends on the shore for us.
Try not to do the basket.
But the real surprise was to find such large numbers of rhino living in the lava flows, and most of them were quite unconcerned by the balloon.
Oh, that's all right. Nice shot. Very nice shot.
On one flight, we saw a dead one. It was the end of the dry season, and I guess he died of hunger. The vultures had been at it, but it still had its horn, so after we landed, I walked back to collect it for the warden. A horn like this is worth a packet, and the park authorities will sell them to Hong Kong. The Chinese think it's an aphrodisiac. The parks needed the money, I needed the exercise, and anyway, it seemed the least I could do for some poor old Chinaman. Over the next few days, we saw dozens of rhino. It was really good to know that there was somewhere in Africa where they still thrived in large numbers. But though it was great country for rhinos, it really wasn't all that good for ballooning. Mike and Giles had to stick to the roads, which often made long detours around lava that we were across in minutes. To save wrecking the cars, we'd try and land as near as we could to a road. But that's easier said than done. And this is one of the few times that we came down within reach of the recovery crew.
Okay, it should be a nice, gentle anyway.
We'll cross the road and land on the other side.
Hello!
I'll rip as we come in. I'll just try and get beyond this lot.
We learnt a lot in Tsavo, and the balloon let us look at life among those lava flows that wouldn't have been possible in any other way. We hadn't found large herds of elephants because the dry season had scattered them, but the place had lived up to its tough reputation. Each landing meant another tear in the fabric, and so we moved once more, this time to Amboseli.
Amboseli is a game reserve just north of Kilimanjaro, Africa's highest mountain. It seemed tailor-made for ballooning, with plenty of wildlife and large open areas ideal for landing. Amboseli is excellent in every way, but it is also a microcosm of most of the problems facing wildlife conservation today, and the balloon provided a perfect way to look at them. The first problem is a natural one. Amboseli only gets about 10 inches of rain a year. The area is an ancient lake bed, and so the soil is a fine alkaline dust that is picked up by the slightest wind and just blows away. The dusty plain is veined with narrow green swamps, where springs, fed by Kilimanjaro's snows and glaciers, pump in the lifeblood that keeps the place going through the dry season. These dense reed beds are the last refuge of the Amboseli herds. Without them, the place would die. But periodically, the water table that backs up these swamps rises too high, and dissolved salts then kill the spectacular yellow-barked acacias, which are such a feature of Amboseli. Dead forests litter the landscape, robbing the earth of shade, animals of food, and the area of much of its beauty. In these desiccated conditions, it is hard for young trees to get started again. In some areas, new acacia forests are growing up, but not nearly enough to replace the losses. But these are natural problems. Amboseli has many more that are man-made. As soon as a wild area is protected, it needs people to protect it. Then, in order to justify its existence, it must attract more people to enjoy it. The facilities for all these people spread like a cancer. Amboseli is a classic example of tourism relentlessly destroying the very attractions that brought the tourists in the first place. They come in their thousands, and their vehicles go everywhere, churning up the powdery soil, destroying vegetation, searching out animals in even the thickest cover, leaving them nowhere to hide. Except for the swamps, the only part of Amboseli that vehicles cannot reach are those covered with a litter of great volcanic rocks.
Easy landing, that one.
These areas can only be visited by animals or by men on foot. As tourists are not allowed to leave the safety of their vehicles, a man on foot here normally means the Maasai.
Up the hill. Something flashing.
It might be the cock.
Some Maasai. It's their fears glinting in the sun.
They're coming this way?
Yes, they're coming down the hill.
Great. Well, maybe, well, at least they can tell us the quickest way out of here. I don't know how Mike and Giles are going to get here.
The Maasai are the traditional owners of Amboseli. They have always been very tolerant of wild animals and content to share their land and grazing with what they call God's cattle. In the past, they sometimes killed lion or rhino with these spears, but only as a sign of manhood and courage. Today, they still do it. But now it's more a show of resentment or frustration against the wildlife authorities with whom they have had a 20-year dispute. It would not be fair to say that the Maasai are just another problem for Amboseli. It's the Maasai that have the problem, reconciling their way of life to the Amboseli that has been conceived by conservationists. But now the Maasai have agreed to move out of the central area of Amboseli and leave it to the wild animals and the tourists. In exchange, they will be given alternate water supplies and a share in the revenues from tourism. They know that in this small area, visitors will be far more profitable than cattle, but though they are practical, they are unlikely to alter their way of life or change their cattle for tourist buses, because the Maasai are unique in the way they grasp the realities of the 20th century yet make so few concessions to it. For these men, the highlight of their balloon ride was not the joys of aviation, but flying over their beloved herds of cattle. In a world that values change for its own sake, the Maasai and the balloon are similar anachronisms. Science could make them more efficient, but tradition gives them their unchanging grace and beauty. While the routes were working in Amboseli, the area was finally given the status of a full national park and taken over by a young African warden. Hopefully, the long vendetta with the Maasai is now over, and Amboseli will have the peaceful future it certainly deserves.
Well, there are those.
Yeah, I mean, off the
day. Yeah, it would be nice to do areas. To do those if we can and then land. Yeah. That's obviously a fairly taking us up now. See you later. Yeah. Shouldn't have been swept way over to the left there. Yeah. I'll try coming down again. Mm-hmm. think it's the higher wind. They just walk south. The sooner they get down, down thermal. Whisk this away. Yeah. What should we do? Should we land here or should we go over those elephants and hope not to go too far left? Do you see if we go too far left?
Yeah, that's
a little bit there. Yeah. I think we ought to reckon on landing over there, actually. We'll try and get to those elephants first.
I think I could stop.
Yeah, don't know about that.
We stayed a couple of weeks in Amboseli. And then, once more, it was time to go. We were very happy with our balloon. It was a great way of filming animals and a magical way of seeing our beloved Africa. Every flight was a feast for the senses, but one flight was to overshadow them all. Whenever you move camp in Africa, you leave part of yourself behind, so packing up is usually a sad occasion. But somehow, this time, we knew we would be back before too long. We knew there was still one thing we had to do. Kilimanjaro, around whose feet we had been floating for so long, is the highest point in Africa. Any balloonist worth his basket would want to look down on that point. We'd have to go to over 20,000 feet, seldom done in a hot air balloon. We'd need oxygen and special clothing. We'd have to do trials and get weather reports, and no doubt permission from all sorts of authorities. We soon found that under the surface glamour of a flight like this, there is a lot of painstaking work. 2 months of work to be exact, but when at last the great day dawned, the weather and the winds were just perfect.
Hang on! Oh, I got the bracket. So did I.
Our flight above the mountain took 4 hours. We went to nearly 25,000 feet and covered 50 miles of forest, gorges and glaciers. For Joan and I, and a balloon called Lengai, it was the ultimate adventure.
Not too close.
Mm-hmm.
first.